Good day and welcome back. So we're going to talk about force on a current carrying conductor. At the end of this video, you should have learned the magnetic force can be applied on current carrying conductor when it is placed in a uniform magnetic field. And then we are going to derive the equations of the magnetic force. Speaking of the current carrying conductor, let us review back what we have learned in chapter 14 about the direct current. So we have derived about the charge and also the current before that chapter. So let us begin with the total charge in the current carrying conductor. So the total charge in the conductor or in the wire is equal to the total number of charge multiplied the charge of electron, since electron should be the charge carrier in the conductor. So the number of charge N is equal to the charge density multiplied the volume of the wire. And then finally, we could express the total charge as NALE, where the volume is equal to the cross-sectional area of the wire multiplied the length of the wire. With this, we can derive the magnetic force acted on all the free electrons in the wire. So we have learned about the formula of QVB sine theta. So we can substitute the expression of the charge as NALE. And then you can rearrange the expression that we have the equations of I equal to nav. And finally, we could express the magnetic force as ILB sine theta. So we have learned about the Fleming left-hand rule, which I also explained in my previous video, except that the second finger now is representing the flow of the current. Besides that, we could also apply the cross product of L and B to obtain the direction of the magnetic force. So let us see some example questions. So I'm sure you have seen this before in SPM Physics. So we have a past year questions which shown in this diagram. So we have the length of the conductor as 10 centimeters. The magnetic flux density is 2 Tesla downward. And we also are given with the static friction force as 0.5 Newton. So you should have learned what is the static friction force in the previous semester. So you need to overcome the static friction force to start to move the conductor. So here we need to calculate the minimum current to move the copper rod. So the magnetic force acted on the copper rod should be equal or more than the static friction force to move the copper rod. So to get the minimum current, we just equate the static friction force equal to the magnetic force, which is equal to ILB that we have derived just now. So the current is equal to the ratio of the static friction force to the product of the length and the magnetic flux density, and you will get the current equal to 2.5 ampere. Next, we're going to see a second example, which is also very familiar that appears in SPM before. So we look at another question from the past year. So you're given with the density and the cross-sectional area of the copper rod PQ. And you could see that there are two magnets that produce the magnetic field acted on the copper rod PQ. And the magnetic flux density is given as 7.9 multiplied 10 to the power negative 2 Tesla. So the copper rod has a mass that is subjected to the gravitational force. So the weight of the copper rod is supported by the tension of the wires. So to swing the copper rod, or means that the tension of the supporting wires is zero, we can provide a current to flow through the copper rod PQ so that a magnetic force is produced to support the weight of the copper rod. So here we can equate the weight, which is equal to mg equal to ILB, and the mass can be expressed as the density multiplied the volume of the copper rod, which is also the product of the cross-sectional area and the length of the copper rod. So we have the equations of the rho ALG equal to ILB. So we could express current as the density multiplied the area and the gravitational force divided by the magnetic flux density. In the end, you could get the answer as 0.14 ampere. So there could be different scenarios regarding this topic. So there is core element to understand those kind of questions, which is about the resultant force. Either it is zero resultant force that can cause stationary or constant velocity of the object, or it can be the non-zero resultant force that can cause the object to accelerate. So we can review back about the resultant force and combine it into this topic to solve the questions in future. So besides the forces on the conductor which has a mass, so now we're going to study the force on a moving charge based on the trial from Yu Hua. So you are given B, the charge as the charge of single positive charge or the proton, and then the mass. And then in the velocity selector, you have the electric field strength of 4 kilovolt per meter and the magnetic flux density of 0.4 Tesla. And then in the second region, we have the magnetic flux density of 0.05 Tesla. So let's look at the velocity selector. So you could apply the Fleming left hand rule that you can obtain the direction of the magnetic force is upward. And since it is a positive charge ion, so we have another electric field strength that exerts a downward force on the charge ion. So since the charge is moving horizontally, so we can conclude that the vertical resultant force is equal to zero, that the upward magnetic force is cancelled by the downward electrostatic force on the charge ion. So here we can substitute the formula of the magnetic force and the electrostatic force, that QVB equal to QE, and you could express the velocity as the ratio of the electric field strength to the magnetic field strength. From here, we could see that the velocity of the charge ion can be adjusted by modifying the strength of the magnetic field or the electric field. In this case, we can calculate the velocity is equal to 1 multiplied 10 to the power 4 meter per second. So when the charge ion enters the second region, things happen as what I've explained in my previous video. So since the magnetic force can cause the circular motions, so it is also the centripetal force, that QVB is equal to mv squared over r. So we have learned about the radius of the circular motion is equal to mv divided by QB. So we can further express r in terms of b1 and b2, that the velocity is equal to the ratio of e to b. So substitute all the value and you could get the radius of the circular path as 0.033 meter. So now let us explore another variable in this question, that what time the charge ion will stop when it enters the second region. Regarding the topic of the centripetal force, we have learned about the period of the motion is equal to the 2 pi r divided by the velocity of the object. So here the ion is moving in semicircle path. So the time can be obtained by the ratio of pi r to the velocity of the ion. And we can find out the time is equal to 1.04 multiplied 10 to the power of 25 seconds. So from this example, you should have understand better about the chemistry between the resultant force and the topics in the magnetic field. So that's all for my discussion today. So if you have further questions, you can leave it in the comment section below. Also do leave a like and subscribe my channel. I'll see you in my next video. Thank you.